Okay, we'll start now the registration.
Okay, so the course will be done with a whiteboard on the tablet. So it means that you will be subject to my horrible handwriting. But so also feel free to ask if you don't understand something that I write. So I will start, as I said, from the very beginning. So what is this optimal transport problem? So I think if you ever met optimal transport, maybe in some conferences, at least for the most advanced researchers among you, you always heard about this story. So optimal transport dates back to a problem asked in the 18th century by Gaspard Monge. And I will translate the problem in modern mathematical language. The problem is the following one. You have a distribution of mass that I will call mu. Mu is a probability measure. So what do I mean by probability measure? Why do I say probability measure? It's just a distribution of mass on a set. It's a positive measure. And we assume that it is finite, and up to scaling, we assume that the total mass is one. So mu is a probability measure on X. It does not really mean that there is a stochastic idea behind it. So probability measure just means a measure in the sense of distribution of mass with total mass one. Then you're given somewhere else a probability measure that they call nu, and it is a probability over a possibly different space y. Now, the drawing that I did, the idea is that I represent some densities on two different spaces. And the question is how to move mass from here to here in the cheapest way. So in modern mathematical language, the question is the following. I have a cost function defined on the product space, defined on x times y, valued in R, sometimes it could be R and plus infinity, but let's say valued in R, which is the cost to move a unit mass from X to Y. So C of XY is the cost to move a unit mass from X to Y. The unknown is a map T from X to Y with a constraint. The constraint is that map transforms the measure mu into the measure nu. Now, this is the image measure. And so let me move the, okay. And what is the image measure? The definition of image measure. So remember that a measure is a quantity which associates with every set a mass. So the image measure T diesis mu applied to a set A in Y, by definition, will be mu of the pre-image of Y. Equivalently, you can define measures with what they do on sets. You can define measure with what they do on functions, because you can use measure to integrate function. Equivalently, when I integrate a function phi according to this image measure, I want that this is the integral of phi composed with t d mu. So this is to give the definition of what is the image measure of a measure through a map. You see that this is an integral on y and this is an integral on x. So remember this. So this is a constraint. And then the problem is to minimize the cost to go from x to t of x. Then you take the average according all the possible x's among all the maps x from x t from x to y, which send mu onto nu. So essentially, in the interpretation of Monge, this was a pile of sand that you have to move during a work, some engineering work with military applications he had in mind. And you take all the mass which is located at the point X, you move it to T of X. You have to do it in a certain way, in the sense that not all the movement T are admissible because you have a constraint on what you get at the end. But there are many which are admissible. And among them, you choose the one which minimizes the cost. So for Monge, the idea was to use X and Y to be subset of R3, mu and nu to be measures which have a density, and this density can be, let's say, a positive function on R3 with integral 1, and the cost C was the distance. Now, this is a calculus of variation problem. A calculus of variation problem because it's a minimization where the unknown is a function. Now, if you know calculus of variation, maybe you have noticed that in many, okay, usually in calculus of variation, you minimize energies where the unknown is a function, but you also involve the derivatives of the function. Because otherwise, if you don't involve the derivative, you can often transform the problem into just a family of optimization problem where for each x, you choose the value t of x, which gives the best value. And if you have derivatives which are involved, you cannot choose freely in one point what you do independently of what you do in the other points. Now here, there is no derivative, but I can show that in some sense there is a derivative. So anyway, you cannot completely choose freely t of x independently of the other because you have a global constraint. Now I guess that you see when I point somewhere, no? I'm pointing here.
Yes.
Okay, thanks. Now, an easy case, so an easy case to be transformed, to be interpreted is, so a simplest case to be considered is if T is smooth and one-to-one and X and Y are in a certain Euclidean space, because in this case, the condition T and mu as a density and nu as another density, in this case, the condition that T sends mu onto nu is equivalent to a condition on the Jacobian of T. Why? Because you come back to the condition that integral of phi d nu should be equal to the integral of phi composed with T d mu. Now you do a change of variable, T of X equals Y, and there is a Jacobian which appears. And the Jacobian is in modulus, and if you want this equality to be true for every phi, this is equivalent to a condition on the Jacobian of T, which is this one. So you can see that in some sense, this is a calculus of variation problem with derivatives, but the derivative is in the constraint and not in the functional. And unfortunately, this constraint is highly nonlinear. It is nonlinear for three reasons. The first is that I take the determinant, and this is probably the worst one. The determinant is a product of elements of the matrix DT. Then there is the modulus. This is not so bad in the sense that in some cases, it's possible to restrict to maps where the determinant is positive. So in some cases, I can get rid of the modulus. And then there is the composition of G with T. This is also nonlinear. This is not so bad because it's lower order, because the derivatives are here. So just the fact that there is the determinant makes this difficult to consider this constraint. Now, Monge, in the 18th century, wrote a long paper, if you want, about this problem, and he described many interesting geometrical properties of the optimal map T in the case where C is the distance. So Monge looked at the case C of XY is the Euclidean distance in R3. He said many interesting and true properties, but he forgot to discuss about one point, which is obvious for us, and it was not at all in the 18th century, it is, does there exist an optimal T? So Monge said, let's take the optimal T, it should be this one, you have some properties and so on. Now, it's not at all evident that there exists, that this minimum is attained, because what do we do in calculus of variation now? We typically try to apply what is called the direct method, so to take a minimizing sequence and to prove that it admits a limit and the limit minimizes. So Monge did not care about the existence of the optimal T. How should we do? Now, for instance, let me do, imagine a very typical cost is the quadratic one. So now if you take a TN, a minimizing sequence, if the cost is the quadratic one, it's quite easy to say that Maybe Tien is bounded in L2, because you minimize something with L2 norm. So you can easily suppose that Tn weakly converges in L2 to something, to MAPT. Now, if the cost is of this form with T, with C, which is an L2 norm, essentially, so here you have an L2 norm with respect to mu, so it's quite easy to say that the cost is lower semi-continuous for the weak convergence. When you are in a Hilbert space or even a Banach space, if you have a sequence which converges weakly, the norm of the limit is smaller than the limit of the norm. So the semi-continuity of the functional for this convergence, maybe it's okay, but the big problem is, can I say that I have that T sends mu onto nu if Tn sends mu onto nu. Now, if I translate into derivatives in this very particular case, you see that it's not obvious at all, because weak convergence works well with linear quantities, with linear constraints, and not with nonlinear. So it's not at all clear that if Tn weakly converges to T, then, and if Tn satisfies the condition on the modulus of the determinant, we don't know if it will be the case for T. And you can have an easy example. So the answer in general, no. Think at this function. So I take a function Tn of this form, for instance. So on the interval 0, 1, I divide the interval 0, 1 into n parts, on each part equal parts. On each part, I do this sort of tenth map. So it's a piecewise affine function, which goes from 0, 1 to, let's say, 0, 1. What is the image measure? So I take mu equal the Lebesgue measure on 0, 1. What is the image measure of Tn, of mu through Tn? Is the uniform measure on the target set, just because you can easily see that each part is uniformly sent to the target interval, and this is repeated n times, and this is independent of n. So I can make a sequence which becomes more and more oscillating, something like this. And what is the weak limit? But it's easy to know when you have oscillation, the weak limit is the average. So Tn weakly converges to the constant 1/2. I call this map T. What is the image measure of mu? It's a Dirac mass at the value of the constant, because all the mass is sent to the same point. So you see that the weak limit of functions does not preserve the image measure. So that's a problem. So it's not easy to prove existence of an optimal map in this way. Now, if you want to see an existence result, you have to wait 2 centuries, in the sense that in the 20th century, Leonid Kantorovich, he's a Russian mathematician working in the optimization of resources, for instance. So he had many results which are related to operation research, to optimization and to application in logistics, for instance, and to economics. And by the way, he got the Nobel Prize in economics. Leonid Kantorovich formulated in a different language essentially the same problem. So Leonid Kantorovich formulated a transport problem in a different way. And we will see that this different way includes the Monge approach, but it's easier to be treated, and then we will be able to make a bridge between the two. So the fact is that we come back to our original question, is how to move mass from X to Y. And the description that Monge did of the movement is, for every X, please tell me where you put the mass in a point that we call T of X. And the unknown is a function. Now, Kantorovich had a different approach, which is the following one. Consider the product space X times Y. And for every pair XY, tell me how much mass goes from X to Y. Of course, if you do as Monge did, that for every X, you move the mass just to a point Y equals T of X, when you consider all the pairs X and Y, if you take a point Y which is different from T of X, you will just say, no, I'm not moving any mass from X to Y. So you accept the answer zero. So you The unknown is for every point, for every pair, tell me how much mass goes from x to y. You can imagine a discrete setting. If there are finitely many points x and finitely many points y, it's very easy. You have to give a number for each pair. You accept the answer zero, so maybe all the mass in x is sent to just one point, y equals t of x. Maybe not. So the unknown now is a measure that I will call gamma, which will be a probability on the product space, which will be a distribution of mass on all the possible pairs. Now, this distribution of mass should be compatible with the constraints. The constraint is that my source measure was mu. So if I take the image measure through the projection, so px goes from the product to x. You associate with every pair just the first component, and py, you associate y. If you take the image measure of gamma through px, you must get mu. And if you take the image measure of gamma through py, you must get nu. Consider that gamma of A cross B, of a rectangle here, means how much mass goes from A to B. So if you consider gamma of A cross everything, by this condition, this should be equal to, by the first condition, sorry, mu of A. So gamma of A cross everything means how much mass goes from A to somewhere, so which means how much mass was in A. It should be mu of A. And gamma of X cross B should be nu of B. So I will have this set that I will call capital pi of mu nu is the set of gamma probabilities on the product space such that they satisfy these two constraints. Now, Kantorovich now proposed this problem, which is minimize the integral of the cost according to the measure gamma on the product space, so which is the same, minimizing the average cost of the movement among measures in pi of mu. This is an extension of the Monge problem, since for every t, so if t goes from x to y and sends mu to nu, then we define a measure gamma sub t probability on x cross y in this way. Gamma sub t will be the image of identity comma t mu. That is, I take mu, which is a measure on x, and each point is brought to a pair x t of x, and I get a measure on x comma y. And you can check that the first projection of gamma t, you only look at the first component, you get mu. And if you take the second projection of gamma t, you only look at the second component, so you get t ds mu, which is nu. So, and also, if I take the cost of c d gamma t, this by definition of the image measure in what it does with functions, I get this, which is exactly the Monge cost. So Monge minimized this quantity among t, Kantorovich minimizes this quantity among gamma. So Kantorovich is more general because it does not only accept gamma t. So the set of gamma t for t is contained but not equal to the set pi min nu. For instance, gamma equals the tensor product between mu and nu belongs to one set but not to the other, in the sense that what is the condition for a gamma here to be on the form gamma t? Essentially, you need that it is concentrated on the graph y equals t of x. So if for every x you distribute the mass in a unique point, then you are of the form gamma t. If you use more points, for instance, you can imagine that you concentrate on several graphs or that you take a product measure, it means that you are admissible for Kantorovich, but not for Monge. Now, The advantage of Kantorovich problem is that for Kantorovich, we know how to prove that there exists a solution. We know how to say many properties of the solution. And in some cases, and this will be the object of what we do between today and the next time, in some cases, which include, luckily, many of the interesting cases, in some cases, we'll be able to prove that the optimal gamma is indeed concentrated on a graph, which means that we also have a solution for the Monge problem. Now, this is one of the main questions of optimal transport theory. When do we have an optimal transport map? Because it's the first question. It's not the only interesting one. In many cases, it is also interesting to study the optimal gamma independently of the fact that it is coming concentrated or not on a graph. In some cases, what is interesting is to study the minimal value. Because, for instance, if you imagine that C is a distance, the minimal value, in some sense, will give a distance between mu and nu. And this will be the object of the next lectures about the vast end distances.
Filippo, just want to report, one of the students, I think, just asked to go a little bit...
More slowly,
yes.
I was going very, very slowly.
Yes,
Of course. Please tell me when I need to go slowly. Okay.
I still invite students, if they have something which is unclear, also to ask. Okay. So I'm sorry, Filippo.
Please, of course. So now, I can summarize what I said so far, which slows me down. So the first starting point is that Monge proposed this problem. You are given two probability measures on X and Y, two different spaces, but you can think that they are subsets of the Euclidean space. You have a cost function, which tells you what is the cost to bring mass from X to Y. In many interesting applications, the cost function is the distance between X and Y or an increasing function of the distance. You look at all the maps which go from X to Y, which have this property. If you distribute the particle according to the measure mu, and then you bring each particle from X to a new position T of X, you look at the new distribution of particle. This is what is called the image measure, and you want it to be equal to nu. So you want to compute among all the possible rearrangements of the position of the particles, the ones which minimize this cost. And as I said, Monge did proposed very interesting properties about the optimizer, but he didn't care about the existence of the optimizer. Now, this problem is not trivial because even in the easiest and smoother case, the one where T is a smooth map, injective, and mu and nu are smooth densities, you can write this constraint as a condition on the Jacobian because there is a change of variable which is involved. The condition on the Jacobian, maybe I can detail this. When you take phi of t of x d mu, now suppose that you do this, so this becomes phi of y, then you have is it better to write in this? So you have f of x, and then you have a Jacobian, because you have dt will be determinant dt y dy. You have dy, sorry, determinant dtx dx, like this. Now here you have phi of y, g of y dy. You have this. Here you have phi of y. Okay. No, it's better to do it in this way. Sorry. You do the change of variable here. Y equals t of x. So this becomes phi of t of x, g of t of x. And then you have to multiply times this term. Now you see that if you want this term to be equal to this one, The good condition is that g of t of x times the determinant is equal to, and this you write is as f of x dx, is equal to f of x dx, which is exactly this condition. It's a condition on the modulus of the determinant. Now, as I said, this is a nonlinear condition. So it's difficult in particular to preserve this condition when you pass to the limit. Now, here I was discussing how could you try to prove the existence of an optimal t? A possible strategy, for instance, if the cost is a square, is that you take a minimizing sequence. You say that when it is minimizing, this quantity stays bounded. So the L2 norm, according to mu, of Tn minus the identity is bounded. So Let's say that you arrive to say that Tn is bounded in L2. So up to a subsequence, you can suppose that Tn converges weakly in L2 to some t. The big problem is that it is not at all clear that the limit t satisfies the same condition. If you think in terms of derivatives, weak convergence is not able to handle non-linear quantities. And here there is the determinant, which is the product, so we're not able to do it. Another easier example is the following. If you're supposed to have a Tn, which is a sequence of oscillating functions, which are piecewise affine and send the interval 0,1 into the interval 0,1 in this sort of uniform way, you take mu to be the uniform measure on 0,1, and you can ensure that the image measure is also the uniform measure, independently of n. But the limit, the weak limit of oscillation, will be the constant equal to the average, 1/2 in this case. In this case, you have the image measure of mu is the uniform measure, and the image measure of mu through Tn is the uniform measure, and the image measure of mu through T is a Dirac mass, which is not at all the limit of this one. So in general, you can have, if your problem is to transport mu, the uniform measure, onto the uniform measure, you can have the Tn as a minimizing sequence, but you're not sure that the limit T will also be admissible. So we don't know how to prove existence for the Monge problem. Forget about it, wait 2 centuries, and then there will be Leonid Kantorovich, a Russian mathematician who also worked a lot on application of mathematics into economics, who proposed a similar but different problem. And essentially, it's the same problem with a different language. His question is the following: how to transport mass from X to Y with a constraint on the initial and the final measure, but the description of the movement is done in a different way. You consider all the pairs X and Y, and you describe the movement by saying for every point X and Y, how much mass goes from X to Y. In general, this means that you are looking for a measure, a distribution of mass on the product, and gamma of a rectangle A cross B stands for how much mass goes from A to B. Now, if you look at gamma of A cross Y, it means how much mass goes from A to somewhere, it means how much mass was in A. You should get mu of A. This condition means that the projection of gamma according to the first marginal should be mu. Gamma of X cross B is how much mass arrives to B from somewhere, it should be nu of B, second condition. Now I give a name, capital pi of mu nu, to the set of all probability measures satisfying this, and then the problem by Kantorovich is to minimize C among the average of C according to gamma, so the integral of C according to gamma, this is a cost per unit mass, and then I integrate according to the mass among all admissible gamma. And it's an extension of the problem of Monge, because if I take something which is admissible for Monge, that is a map from X to Y with fixed image measure, I can construct something which is admissible for Kantorovich. I can construct a measure which is called gamma sub T, which is obtained as the image of mu through the pair identity comma T. And now I can check that when I look at the first marginal, I get mu, and I look at the second, I get the image of mu through T, that is nu. And if I take the cost of C according to this gamma T, so maybe I should give a name, this cost, I can call it the Kantorovich cost of gamma. So this is K of gamma T, and this will be the Monge cost of T. So when you take the Kantorovich cost of gamma T, you exactly guess, but get by definition of the image measure, the Monge cost of T. The fact is that in the set of admissible competitors for Kantorovich, there are gammas which are not admissible for Monge because they are not coming from a map T. They are not concentrated on a graph T. So now what we want to prove now is that the Kantorovich problem has a solution under some conditions. And then what we will see later is that studying the solution of Kantorovich, in some cases we will be able to say that they are of this form and there is an optimal map T for our cost. And as I said, this is one of the questions that we are interested in optimal transport theory, but not the only one. So now, existence of solution for Kantorovich. This is the next part of the theory that I want to say. Now, the assumptions that I will use are the simplest one, is that X and Y are compact metric spaces. C, defined on X cross Y Waldner, is continuous. The ingredients of the problem are these ones, X, Y, the measures, so mu and nu are just arbitrary probability measures. So I don't assume anything on mu and nu so far, but I assume compactness of the spaces and continuity of the function. Theorem. Under this assumption, there exists a gamma solution of minimum k of gamma in pi of minimum. That is the Kantorovich problem. Now, what will be the proof? The proof will be done via the same method that I tried to apply to Monge, that is, I take a minimizing sequence, I try to prove that it admits a converging subsequence and that the limit minimizes. The idea, so the what I have to recall is that the set of measures on a compact space is the dual of continuous function on the same space. So if X is compact. So if X is compact, the Ries representation theorem says that every continuous function, typically is the following, is every continuous function on the space of continuous function on X, which has a positivity property, that is the result computed on a positive function is positive, can be represented as the integration against a measure. If you remove the positivity property against a positive measure, if you remove the positivity property, then you can represent as a continuous function on the space of continuous functions, so every continuous functional on the space of continuous functions, as the integration against a measure which is not necessarily positive. So measures on X are finite, let's say scalar measures on X, not necessarily positive. There is a norm on this space, which by definition, if you use the fact that it is the dual, should be the sup of the integral of phi d mu among all the function phi, which have a norm smaller than one, but the norm on continuous function is the sup norm, but it is also equal to the mass of mu. If it is positive, if it is not positive, you have to compute the measure which is called the total variation measure of mu, which is essentially its absolute value. Now, probabilities on X are contained in this space, and for every mu probability, the mass is one. So this, the set of probabilities on a space, is a bounded subset of the space of measures on X. Now, what I'm saying here is true if X is compact, because if X is not compact, the space of continuous function is not even a Banach space, because the norm, which is usually the subnorm, is not even finite, and you have to use a norm which is well defined. You could use the set of continuous and bounded functions, but this result would be false this result in this way is false if X is not compact. It's true if you use the space which is called the C0 function, which are the functions which vanish at infinity, but I will stick to the compact case so far. Now, this it's a separable Banach space. So you can use the Banach-Calaoglu theorem, which says that Banach-Calaoglu theorem says that if I have a sequence, so For every sequence xi n in the dual of a certain Banach and separable space, if xi n is bounded, then there exists a subsequence which weakly star converges to something. Now, here Z will be the space of measures, and we will have the weak, so the weak star converge. I will take a sequence of probabilities. For instance, in this case, so what I want to say is the following. If I have mu n, a sequence of probabilities in a certain space X, there exists mu n k, which weakly star converges to another probability measure on X, such that, and this means that phi d mu n k converges to the integral of phi d mu for every phi continuous on X. Now, the Banach-Loglu theorem just says that there exists a subsequence, there exists a limit in the dual. So actually, so far, I should say that this limit is a measure, because it's an element of the dual. I don't know if it is a probability. What is a probability? A probability is a measure which has two properties. It is positive and it has mass one. If this is true for every function phi, I take phi positive. This is positive because the mu and k are probabilities, and they deduce that for every function phi positive, integral of phi d mu is positive. This means that mu is a positive measure. Now I can take phi equals one, and I have the mass of mu and k, which is one, and I deduce that the mass of mu is one. So this means that mu is a probability measure. This can only be done when I am in a compact space, because if I am in non-compact space, the function one cannot be used because I need to use functions which vanish at infinity or something like this. Anyway, I will not care about this. So here I will write this. Now, I wrote this with measures mu on a space X, but I want to apply to measures gamma on the space X cross Y. So now I will do, this is my function analysis parenthesis. Now I will do proof of the theorem. Let gamma n in pi of mu nu be a minimizing sequence up to subsequences. I can assume that gamma n weakly converges to a certain gamma, which will also be a probability on X cross Y. Can I say that gamma belongs to pi mu nu? Yes, because if I take phi of X d gamma n, notice that gamma n is a probability on the product space. I integrate against a function which by chance only depends on X. This is phi d mu, because gamma n is in pi mu nu, which implies that the projection on X of gamma n is equal to mu. So here I'm integrating phi of X. So phi only depends on the first variable. So I'm taking phi, I can write phi of X is equal to phi of px of xy. So then I take the image measure, but the image measure by assumption is mu. But this should converge to phi of X d gamma, because I have a weak convergence of gamma n, and phi, I take phi, a continuous function on X. A continuous function on X is a continuous function on the product, which by chance only depends on one variable. So I deduce that phi of X d gamma is equal to phi d mu for every phi. So somebody has joined the call. It's true, no? Ah, and you also left. So this means that the projection of gamma to x is also mu. And you can do the same for y. So what I claim is that when you have weak convergence of probability measures, their image measure through a fixed continuous map passes through the limit. So if all the gamma n add as an image measure respectively mu and nu, the same will be true for gamma. So the answer is yes. So this is a difference between what happens with Monge and Kantorovich. The constraint passes to the limit. And then, what about k of gamma n? K of gamma n is the integral of c d gamma n. But I was supposing that c was continuous. So by definition of weak convergence, this converges to c d gamma, which is k of gamma. So k of gamma n was a minimizing sequence, which means that by definition of minimizing sequence, this was converging to the inf of k. So I deduce that k of gamma is equal to the inf of k. Which implies that gamma is optimal. So I did the proof by hand, but essentially what I'm saying is that this set is compact and this function is continuous. For which convergence? For the weak convergence of probability measures. Okay? So please tell me if I went too fast on this proof. So if C is continuous, what you're doing is to minimize a continuous functional on a compact set. But when I say continuous and compact, I have to choose which topology do I use. I decide that I use the topology of weak star convergence of probability measures when I see probability measures as the dual of continuous function. And so essentially the continuity of the function is by definition, because the function is a linear functional of the form integrating a continuous function against gamma. And the constraint is being a probability and having some fixed marginal. And this is stable for weak convergence. Okay? So the Kantorovich problem has a solution under very general assumptions. Now, just few words about extensions. You can stick to the compact and continuous case, but few words. Or more general cases. If C is not continuous, but lower semi-continuous. So every time that you minimize, you like lower semi-continuity, because you know, in this proof, I don't really need that this guy tends to this guy. If I had an inequality, if I could prove that the limit functional, the functional on the limit is smaller than this limit, if I had an inequality like this, it would have been enough, because I would have obtained that k of gamma was smaller than the inf. And since it cannot be strictly smaller than the inf, I get anyway the inequality. So this is why in optimization, it's enough to minimize a lower semi-continuous functional on a compact set. So if C is not continuous but lower semi-continuous, then there is a fact that every function can be written as a limit, let's say when j tends to infinity of some. So every lower semi-continuous function can be written as an increasing limit where Cj is J Lipschitz. There is an explicit formula for this. You can define. So this is on every space. So maybe I will not use x and y as a variable, but z. Cj of z to be the inf of C of z prime plus j distance between z and z prime inf over z prime. So if you are given a function c, which is lower semi-continuous, you can define a function cj in this way. You take the value of c on an arbitrary point plus j times the distance between z and z prime. The result depends on j. You can easily see that this function for fixed j is Lipschitz continuous with constant j, because In terms of Z, this quantity is, this is one Lipschitz, the distance function by the triangle inequality is one Lipschitz, and I multiply times J. And this is a constant in Z. Then I take an infimum of a family of functions which are all Lipschitz with the same constant, and the result is also Lipschitz with the same constant. This is, so I treat Z prime as a parameter. Now here, Z will be the pair XY, because I will have functions on the product. You can prove that, of course, this sequence that I defined for every J, if you increase J, the result increases. But level string continuous and bounded from below, but you don't really bounded. You don't really need, if you are in a compact space, but lower semi-continuous functions are of course bounded from below. So you can prove that if you increase J, this result increases. And using the fact that C is lower semi-continuous, you can prove that the increasing limit of this Cj of Z is C of Z. So every lower semi-continuous function is an increasing limit of continuous functions. Then define Kj of gamma to be the integral of Cj di gamma. And by monotone convergence, Kj of gamma increasingly tends to K of gamma, which means that K is also the sup over J of Kj. And now, each Kj is continuous on the space P mu nu, and so a sup of continuous functions is Lauer semi-continuous. So Kj is continuous for the weak star convergence. Lauer semi-continuous for the weak star convergence. So you could prove that if you define, so essentially what I'm saying is that if your cost C is continuous, the integral quantity is continuous for the weak star convergence of gamma. If your cost C is Lauer semi-continuous, the integral is Lauer semi-continuous for the same convergence. And the way to prove it is to write a Lauer semi-continuous function as an increasing limit of continuous functions. Then you consider the integral functional associated with each continuous function. It is continuous. And then you take the sup, which is an increasing limit, and by monotone convergence, you can prove that this converges to K of gamma. So this is a possible extension if you want to consider a cost which is not continuous, but Lauer semi-continuous. In particular, for instance, it can be used for cost which includes some constraints, so a cost which takes the value plus infinity in some cases, for instance. Another extension, but I will really not insist on this. If X or Y are not compact. Actually, it's not so much a problem, but I will really not detail this. You can get, we can get anyway the compactness of pi of mu nu using Prokhorov's theorem which says that if a sequence of probabilities on a certain space and that will apply to X cross Y is tight, which means for every epsilon there exists a compact depending on epsilon, such that the measure which is given to the complement of this set is smaller than epsilon uniformly in N, then there exists a subsequence, there exists a mu, which is also a probability, such that this converges in duality with continuous and bounded functions to mu, that is integral of phi d mu and k converges to integral of phi d mu for every phi which is continuous and bounded on x. And so what you do is that you prove that there exists a minimizer by using not the weak star convergence in duality with continuous functions, because you cannot, because you are in a non-compact space, so continuous functions are not a Banach space. You use continuous and bounded. For continuous and bounded, you cannot directly apply Banach-Calaoglu because it is not true that the measures are the dual of continuous and bounded, but you apply this Prokhorov theorem because you can prove that the gamma n, so it is, we can prove that gamma n in pi mu nu is tight, and this is because of the constraint. The fact that all the gamma n's have the same marginals mu and nu tells you that you cannot give too much mass very far, because mu and nu cannot. And so the sequence will be compact for this convergence, and then you can prove that the functional is also lower semi-continuous for this convergence. But I prefer not to insist on this case because it requires a little bit of details, and we can already have many interesting properties in the compact case. So I summarize. The problem by Kantorovich is this one. Minimize the integral of C d gamma among gamma admissible measures. So these measures are called transport plans. How can we prove that there exists a solution? So first, remember a functional analysis effect. Measures on a compact space, measures are the dual of continuous function. Continuous functions are a separable Banach space. So if you have a bounded sequence in the space of measures, you can extract a weakly star converging subsequence. Probabilities, they are special measures with mass one, so they are bounded. So every time that you have a sequence of probability measures on a compact space, you can extract a subsequence which converges in duality with all continuous functions. So the integral of continuous functions converge. And the limit will also be a probability. Now, I apply it to the case where I take a minimizing sequence in this admissible set. Since it is a sequence of probability measures on the space x cross y, which is compact, I can extract a converging subsequence. And now I can see that according to this convergence, the constraint passes to the limit. The constraint is, being a probability measure, we said it was okay, and having marginal equal to mu, for instance. I take a test function, phi d mu is equal to phi composed with pi x d gamma n, but this converges to phi d gamma. So I deduce that phi of x d gamma is equal to phi d mu for every phi. This means that the constraint is satisfied by mu, and I can do the same for y. And then if I look at the cost function, it is the integral of a fixed continuous function, so for sure it passes to the limit. So essentially I'm saying that this is a continuous functional and this is a compact space. I can extend if my cost was not continuous but lower semi-continuous by writing this functional as a soup of continuous functions. I can also extend to the case where they are not compact, the spaces, but this is more delicate because I should change the convergence. The idea is that this set is not an arbitrary set of probability measures on a non-compact space. Since you fix the marginals, you cannot bring too much mass close to infinity. So this is one of the advantages, the good points of Kantorovich is existence of the optimal gamma. It is not the only one. Now I write it in red because it's important. Kantorovich problem is convex. Now, if you come back to the original problem by Monge, you minimize a function with a constraint. Now, this function may be for some C, it can be a convex function of T of X. For instance, if you use the distance or the distance square and so on. But the constraint is not at all convex because it's an equality constraint with nonlinear quantities. So the set of T, which are admissible, is not convex. Now, if you look at the problem by Kantorovich, the quantity that you minimize is linear in gamma. And the constraint is that you should be positive, because it should be a probability measure, that you should have mass one, this is linear, so you end it for every phi, this is the constraint essentially, that for every phi of x d gamma should be equal to something, phi d mu. So the constraints are linear. Now let me write in this way, so I minimize integral of c d gamma under this condition. Gamma positive, and for every phi continuous on x, integral of phi of x d gamma integral equals integral of phi d mu, and for every psi continuous on y, integral of psi of y d gamma should be equal to the integral of psi d mu. Now I don't write, so when I said that gamma is a probability measure, I should write that it is positive, and I should also write that the mass is one, but since you can take the function phi equals one, here it is written. If you take phi equals one, I'm writing that the integral of one d gamma, the mass of gamma, should be equal to the mass of mu, which is one. So this is linear. These are linear. And also this. So essentially, it's not only convex, it's linear programming. If it was in finite dimension, if x and y are finite, this is, in the end, a measure on a finite space is just giving how much mass to each point. So in the end, you are solving a linear programming problem and people from operation research, they have algorithms, maybe you know the simplex algorithm, of course, it's not the most efficient one, but it's really a very classical problem in optimization, minimizing a linear quantity under linear constraints with equality or inequality. Now, convexity also brings another very important idea, which is what is called convex duality. Now, I will explain heuristically how to obtain from this problem what is called another problem, which is called the dual problem, by means of an inf-superexchange procedure. And starting from this problem, I will the second problem, which is different, but the connection between the two problems will bring many informations on the minimizers of one and of the other. So in convex optimization, very often what you do is we have an optimization problem, we build a second one. So instead of solving just one problem and spending a lot of effort to obtain properties of the solution, I will solve two problems and getting less properties of the solution on each of the two problems will then finally give me a lot of information on the solution of both problems. So what I will do now is the following one. Let me take this optimization problem. I move to the next page. And I will rewrite. Let me rewrite this problem as a min-max. So the idea is the following. I'm minimizing among gamma this quantity, cd gamma, but then I have some constraints. Let me write this constraint in this way. So let me do this, and then we check that I have the same. Sup over phi of phi d mu minus phi of x d gamma plus sup over psi, let's say sup over phi and psi, plus psi d nu minus psi of y d gamma. Now, look at this. So here I have two parts. One, Okay, it's a soup over five psi, but one part only involves psi and the other only involves psi. What is soup over phi of phi d mu minus phi of x d gamma? There are two possibilities for the values of the soup. So now phi is my mute variable. The result depends on mu and gamma. There are two possibilities. Maybe by chance, for every phi, this is zero. But for every phi, this quantity being zero, we know that it is equivalent to the project, the image measure of gamma through p of x is mu. So maybe by chance, for every phi, this is zero, in which case the soup is zero. Maybe it is not true that it is zero for every phi. There exists at least a function phi for which this is non-zero. But since I'm not putting essentially any constraint on phi, if I will take a function in c of x, I can multiply my phi. Once I get a phi for which this is not zero, I can multiply my phi times 1 billion or 10 billion or whatever I want. The soup will be plus infinity. So if I have at least one function phi for which this result is non-zero, if it is positive, I multiply it times a huge constant which tends to infinity. If it is negative, I multiply it times a huge constant tending to minus infinity. In both cases, I'm able to make the soup being equal to plus infinity. So the quantity that I add here is either zero or plus infinity according to the fact that I satisfy or not this condition. The soup over psi will also be in the same way zero if the image of gamma through py is new, plus infinity if not. So adding these two soups is equivalent to adding these two constraints, because I'm adding a functional which takes the value zero is if I satisfy the constraint, plus infinity if not, and I am in a minimization problem. Plus infinity in a minimization problem means a constraint. I keep explicitly my constraint gamma positive. So I wrote my original problem as a min over gamma of a quantity which is a soup over phi m psi. Now let me switch the inf and the soup in this way. So I have this, I write it here. What happens if I switch inf and the soup? So this mean, you can imagine that is an inf. So what does it mean? It means that I have a quantity which is written as a quantity of two variables. One variable is gamma and one variable is the pair phi psi. And I have, here I first compute the soup over phi m psi and then I compute the inf over gamma. Let us do the opposite. It's something different. It has nothing to do a priori with the original problem, but we can compute this soup over phi m psi of inf over gamma. Gamma is not taken arbitrary, so phi is in C of X, psi is in C of Y. Gamma is an arbitrary positive measure of the inf of this. Now let's write the quantity C d gamma plus phi d mu minus phi of X d gamma plus psi d nu minus psi of Y d gamma. Now there are five terms here, but two of them don't have gamma. So it means that these two terms can be brought out of the inf. So I have soup over phi m psi of phi d mu plus psi d nu plus inf over gamma positive of an integral that I can write in this way, c of xy minus phi of x minus psi of y d gamma, and gamma is positive. Now, same question as before. What is the value of this inf? There are, I also distinguish two cases. If by chance C is larger than this function phi plus psi, actually it's better to write in this way because this C of xy larger than phi of x plus psi of y. If by chance this function is positive, when I integrate against something positive, I get something positive, but since I can use gamma equals zero, the inf is zero. So if by chance the integrand is positive, then the inf is zero. Now this is, remember that phi and psi are fixed and my inf is on gamma, so the result will depend on phi and psi. If by chance there is at least one point where this is non-zero, this is non-positive, sorry, if this is negative somewhere, since gamma is an arbitrary measure, positive measure, I don't have anymore any constraint on the margin, on the image measures of gamma. I'm forgetting, I replaced the constraints with the sup on phi and psi. And now I'm computing from the, my inf sup problem, another problem, which is the sup inf. If by chance this is negative somewhere, I can put a lot of mass in the point where it is negative. I can put one billion times the Dirac mass in this point, and the inf will be minus infinity. So it means that this inf will also be of the form zero infinity, but is zero minus infinity because I am in a maximization problem. So I'm maximizing among phi and psi. If I have a quantity plus something which is zero or minus infinity, this is the same. In the end, I get sup over phi and psi of the integral of phi d mu plus psi d nu under the constraint phi of x plus psi of y less than c of xy. So phi and psi are not arbitrary, they should satisfy this constraint, which is an inequality. So this is called the dual Kantorovich problem. Now, so far I only showed that I start from my primal Kantorovich problem, and with a manipulation, I can obtain a new problem, which a priori has nothing to do with the previous one, up to the fact that I obtained it from it after manipulations. Some remarks on this problem. First of all, you see that the original problem was had mu and nu in the constraints and c in the the objective function to be optimized. Now here I have mu and nu in the objective functions that I try to optimize and c is in the constraint. It's typical that you switch constraints and functions when you pass from primal to dual. Then purist people in functional analysis would say that this is the primal problem and the one with measures is the dual, because measures are the dual of functions and functions are not the dual of measures. So here they are continuous functions, no? Phi in C of X and psi in C of Y. So this is a problem where you maximize among functions, among phi and psi in a certain space, and the other ones, the other problem you minimize among measures in the dual of these. So formally, this should be the primal and the other one should be the dual. But let's say that typically we call dual the second problem that we meet. And so the first one will be called the primal. Now, how did I obtain this? It means that I had a function of two variables. A was gamma and B was the pair phi and psi. And I consider inf on A sup over B on A and B, L and B, or sup on B and inf on A of L and B, A and B. Can I say that these two are equal, the values? So there are two different problems. Can I say at least that the value is the same, so that there is a true connection between the two? And the answer is that in general, I have this inequality. You can easily see that, so for every function L of two variables, what you can do is you fix A0 B0, you can say that L A0 B0 for sure is larger than inf over A of L A B0, because you have a point and you compare to the inf. Now I can say, I can take the sup over B0 here. If the inequality is true for every B0, I can take the sup. Now, here you obtain, here you have a number, because you have two variables, A and B0, and you have inf over A and sup over B0. This is a number. This is something which still depends on A0, so I can take the inf over A0. You see that, and here you can decide that your A, you call it A0, or that your A0, B0 are called A and B. So here you have the inf sup. The inf sup is always larger than sup inf. There are theorems in convex analysis providing inf sup equals sup inf under some conditions. Typically, the function L should be concave in the variable where you maximize, should be convex in the variable where you minimize, plus some compactness. Here, our function L, so it's depends on gamma and on phi psi, is integral of C d gamma plus phi d mu minus phi of x d gamma plus psi d nu minus psi of y d gamma. You see that it is bilinear. It is separately linear in gamma and linear in phi and psi. There are terms which combine phi and gamma and psi and gamma. Since it is linear in gamma, it is convex in gamma. Since it is linear in phi psi, it is concave in phi and psi. And you have to work to obtain the compactness. Anyway, next time I will prove that I have the equality. So, next time I'll prove that this is equal to the sup of this. Now, I want to prove that the dual also admits the solution. So, because this problem is a maximization among phi and psi, I want to prove that it admits the solution. For people who know about this general convex duality, in particular, keeping in mind that this should be the primal. Very often the primal has no solution, the dual has solution. Why? Because the dual is a problem which is set in a dual space, on which you have better compactness result for the weak star convergence. So here it is more delicate to prove the solution. Here it was clear from the very beginning that there was a solution because gamma lives in a compact space. Here phi and psi do not live in a compact space because they are continuous functions, and I'm not putting any constraint on their continuity. So the constraints that I have are not enough to guarantee compactness. So I have to work a little bit to prove that it admits a solution. So please stop me if you have questions, if I'm going too far. So essentially what I'm doing now is the following. I have a primal problem. With some manipulations, I constructed another problem, which I call a dual problem, which has the same ingredients, mu, nu, and c. But so far, I didn't prove that it has a specific relation with the previous one. Of course, it has some relation because it was obtained by switching an inf and a sup into a sup and a inf. I want to prove that it has a solution. Now, a trick. If I have an admissible pair phi and psi for the dual, Let's improve it. Fixify. What's the best psi? I mean, it's a problem on pairs, where you see mu and nu are positive measures. So I would like to have phi and psi as large as possible because I'm trying to maximize the integral of phi and psi. But I have a constraint which prevents me to take phi and psi as large as possible. Now, suppose that you choose a pair phi and psi, and now you fix your phi, you don't change your phi, but you accept to change your psi. What is the best psi? You want the maximal possible psi. Remember that you have this constraint. Psi of y should be smaller than c of xy minus phi of x, because I need this constraint. I write just bringing the phi here. This should be true for every x, so I can write inf over x. Now, if you think a little bit about it, this is a function of the variable y, written as an inf over x of some quantities. It's a function which depends on phi. It is constructed starting from phi. We will call it phi c of y. So the c transform of phi. Now, for those who know a little bit about convex functions, and we will also discuss it next time, this recalls a lot the Legendre transform of convex function. The Legendre transform of convex function is defined as a sup of a scalar product minus the other function. Here, instead of the scalar product, I'm using c of xy. So it's a sort of generalization. There is a lot of literature about these c convex functions. Now, unfortunately, since I'm using the inf and not the sup, I will not. The analogy is a little bit spurious. The analogy is that this is analogous to concave function because of the inf. So these functions are called C concave functions. Anyway, the best possible psi is this one. So if I give you a function phi, it's useless to use another function psi different from phi c. Phi c is the best possible one. Then I can also do the same argument with psi. If I have a function psi, what is the best phi? It will be to use psi c. So, theorem, if x and y are compact, c is continuous. There exists phi psi, a pair in c of x times times c of y, solution of max phi d mu plus psi d nu such that phi plus psi is smaller than c. So this is my theorem, proof. Take a maximizing sequence phi n psi n. This is the first step. Second, improve it. Replacing psi n with phi n c. So let's call it second other step. Improve it again. Replacing phi n with phi n c, c. It means we can assume that phi n and psi n are c concave. So maybe I write it here. Definition. A function is said to be C concave if it is the C transform of something. You can also think of the case of convex functions. The definition of a convex function is given with the chord and the behavior of with convex combination and so on. But you can prove, and it's not trivial thanks to the Banach theorem, that a function is convex if and only if it is the Fenchel transform of something. Now, we can assume that they are second case. We can also always add a constant to phi n, provided we subtract it from psi n. So if you add the constant to phi and you subtract it from psi, the constraint is satisfied if you add and subtract the same constant, and the function does not change because I'm adding a constant times the mass of mu minus the constant times the mass of nu, and mu and nu have the same mass. So I can assume phi n psi n c concave, and let's say inf over x of phi n equals 0. Now, let me go on. Fact, C concave functions have the same modulus of continuity as C. Actually, this fact, I should have also said it before, because the optimization is among functions phi and psi, which are continuous. I wrote it here. And so I gave this formula. I didn't discuss if it was a continuous function. It is. Why is it? Because suppose that you have a property of this form, for instance. Now, I'm just writing the modulus of continuity according to the variable y. Suppose that there exists a function omega from R plus to R plus with omega of 0 equals 0, continuous, such that you have this. This for sure it exists, because C is continuous on a compact set. Continuous on a compact set means uniformly continuous. Uniformly continuous means that there exists a modulus of continuity which exists exactly this, that you can bound the difference of two values with a function of the distance. Now, look at phi c of y, which is inf over x of c of x y minus phi of x. Now, let me write in this way. C of x y, I write it is smaller than C of x y prime plus omega distance y y prime. I'm just comparing this guy to this guy because of this inequality. Minus phi of x. Now, this term with omega does not involve x, so I can bring it out of the inf plus inf over x C of x y prime minus phi of x, but this is by definition phi c of y prime. So I proved that phi c of y minus phi c of y prime is smaller than omega distance of y y prime. If I exchange y and y prime, I obtain the opposite inequality. I obtain that phi c as modulus of continuity omega. So when I take whatever is phi, this is the important point, whatever is phi, phi c is a continuous function with the modulus of continuity, which is given by the modulus of continuity of the cost c. Analogously, it works for psi c of c, which is of x, which is inf over y, if you have c of xy minus c of x prime y smaller than omega distance of x x prime. So essentially, you don't really need the modulus of continuity of C in two variables, but the two separate modulus of continuity is the same. So C is a continuous function of a product space, compact, so it is uniformly continuous. So there exists a modulus of continuity omega, and you have this. So this means that, first of all, this means that the function phi C and psi C that I'm obtaining are continuous, so they are still admissible. Also, since C is continuous on a compact space, C is bounded. It means that the oscillation of phi is smaller than omega of the, so if phi, okay, let's say, if phi is psi C, this is smaller than omega of the diameter of X. Oscillation of phi means the maximal value minus the minimal value, because it just you just apply this inequality with two different points. Now, so it means that the function is bounded. So phi it's continuous, so it is bounded on each compact space. So it means, as I did, that up to adding a constant, I can assume that the inf is zero. So now, I do it for this function. Remember that I can take phi n psi n up to improving it. I can assume that the second is the transform of something, and the first is the transform of the second. I can assume, adding a constant, that the inf of phi n is zero. Now, I have this. Inf of phi n is zero. What is the sup of phi n? It's at most omega of the diameter of x, because of this. What about psi n? So phi n, which was okay, sorry. Maybe the name. So I assume that phi n and psi n are C concave. So I don't use anymore the fact that maybe I should. Okay, let's do it with psi. Probably it's better. C concave, and in phi n of zero, and phi n is the transform of C. And so maybe let's assume that the inf of psi n. So with this construction, I obtain that the first one is the transform of the second, but not that the second is the transform of the first. Actually, it is true, but I will not insist. So I assume that inf of psi n is zero. So now I have that the inf of psi n is zero. The sup of psi n, so it's omega of the diameter of y. Now, what about phi n? Remember that phi n is psi n c, which means that phi n of x is inf c of xy minus psi n of y. But since psi is positive, this is smaller than the inf over y of c of xy, which is smaller than, let's say, the infinite norm of C. This is an upper bound, so I get sup of phi n smaller than C. What about the inf of phi n? Since psi n is bounded by this, I can also say that it is bounded by inf of C of xy minus omega of the diameter of y. So in the end, it will be bounded minus a constant. I write it here, sorry. This guy. So globally, I get that phi n, sorry, psi n is bounded in this way, and phi n is bounded by so I have uniform bounds on phi n and psi n. Now phi n and psi n satisfy the assumptions of Ascoli-Arzelà theorem, since they are equibounded and equicontinuous. Equicontinuous, since they all have the same modulus of continuity, which is the one by I'm trying to move your face, Alessio, which is exactly where I wanted to write, but I don't succeed. Okay. Since they have the modulus of continuity omega. So there exists some subsequence which uniformly converge to a pair phi and psi, which is a function on continuous on x and a function continuous on y, and the inequality, we add this inequality, which obviously passes to the limit. Actually, to make this inequality pass to the limit, you just need pointwise convergence. And the integral of phi nk d mu plus psi nk d nu converges to phi d mu psi d nu by, again, pointwise dominated convergence would be enough, but here it is uniform convergence. So phi psi maximizes the dual problem. So in this case, it is not true that the problem is set on a space which is compact. The set of admissible pairs phi and psi is not compact. For instance, because you can add constants and so on. But you can, once you take a maximizing sequence, you can improve it so as to belong to a compact space. So it means that you maximize over a set which is not compact, but there exists a subset which is enough to attain the soup, which is compact. For which convergence? For the uniform convergence. So now I have this first problem, C d gamma, gamma in P mu nu. I have this other one, max phi d mu plus psi d nu, phi plus psi smaller than c. They both have solutions, and I will prove next time that the values are the same. Now, maybe in the last minutes, I can, unless you have questions, of course, I can show you how to use these relations between the two problems if we believe for a while that the values are the same. This will be proven next time, at least some information. Then I will discuss more next time. So if we believe mean of the primal equals max of the dual, we can get many information, much information, a lot of information. Now, why? Take gamma phi and psi optimal. So I mean gamma optimal for the primal problem and phi psi optimal for the dual. Look and believe, so this is the assumption, believe that the values are the same. It means that I have this. So this is equal to the minimum of Kantorovich, and this is equal to the maximum of the dual. Now, I will write this term in this form, phi of x plus psi of y d gamma. I'm using the fact that gamma is admissible. If gamma is admissible, the projection of gamma on X is mu, the projection of gamma on Y is nu. So when I integrate a function of X according to gamma, I get the integral with mu. And then when I integrate a function of Y according to gamma, I got the integral of the same function according to mu. Now, it means that this integral is equal to this one, but we have C larger than phi plus psi. I'm using that phi and psi are admissible. It means that if they're all optimal, then I get that C is equal to phi plus psi gamma almost everywhere, because I have a function which is larger than the other, but the integral is the same. Since C, phi, and psi are continuous, the equality should be true on the support. In the sense that the support is the smallest closed set on which the measure is concentrated. So I know that there is a set on which the measure is concentrated, on which this equality is true, but this equality is true on a closed set because the functions are continuous. So actually, this is what is called the primal dual optimality condition. It's something like this. Gamma phi psi admissible are optimal if and only if C is equal to phi plus psi on support of gamma. So what I proved in the previous page is this. If you take a triple gamma phi psi of optimal choices, and since they are optimal, they are of course admissible, then I proved that C is equal to phi plus psi on support of gamma. So what I proved is this one. And I use equality between primal and dual. For the reverse implication, you don't even use equality. Suppose that you have gamma phi psi which are admissible. Now, this means that this is larger than the minimum of the primal. I already showed that the minimum of the primal is larger than the sup of the dual, because it's always true when I do an if-sup exchange. And this is larger than phi d mu plus psi d nu. If this is equal to C d gamma, which is true because of this condition, because, so maybe I do it an extra step. This is equal to phi plus psi d gamma, since I use admissibility of gamma. If on the support of gamma, phi plus psi is equal to C, then this guy is equal to this one. So all the inequalities are equalities. So if you have a triple gamma phi psi, which is admissible, and which satisfies this equality on the support of gamma, then automatically gamma is optimal in the primal, phi psi is optimal in the dual, and they have no gap between the value of the primal and the dual. So this is a very strong sufficient optimality condition. So a sufficient optimality condition is that C is equal to phi plus psi on the support of gamma. It is also necessary as an optimality condition, but to prove the necessity, I use the equality between min and max. So there is a part of the duality which does not require to prove that the mean is equal to max, but I will need to prove it because I want to say, and this is what I will do now. So I said, if gamma phi psi are optimal, then C is equal to phi plus psi on the support of gamma. Now, this will be the last thing that I will say. Take x0, y0 in the support of gamma, and then I can write this. I can write this inequality, which is true for every x. Actually, it would also be true for every Y. I could also change Y, but I don't. On the other hand, I have equality. Because if I take X equals X naught, I am on the support of gamma where I have equality. So it means that the function C of X Y naught minus phi of X is minimal at X equals X naught. So I can deduce that a certain function of the variable x is minimized at x equals x naught. Now, particular case, I will do x and y in Rn, and c, which is c1. Suppose for a while that there exists grad phi at the point x naught, what can I deduce? I can deduce that the gradient with respect to x of c in the minimal point minus the gradient of phi should be zero. You agree that if you have a minimum point, then it is if you minimize a function and this function is differentiable, then the gradient must vanish. Now you should also suppose that x does not belong to the boundary, if you want. But this is really not a problem because x and y don't play a lot of role in the sense that suppose that you have your measure mu in a set x, but then you just enlarge x. If you take an x which is larger than the support of mu, so that you can ensure that no point on the support is on the boundary. So this is not a big problem. Anyway, you have this. Now, an assumption on C, which is called the twist condition. Suppose that for every x, the function which maps y into the gradient with respect to x of c to every for every x naught, let's say, this function is injective. So suppose that you have a function c which is c1, and the gradient with respect to x is injective with respect to y. Then I can prove that for every x naught, only one point y naught can be such that x naught y naught belongs to the support of gamma. Because come back to this condition. I have gradient with respect to x of c computing x naught something is equal to something given which only depends on x naught and not y naught. So I fix x naught, I compute grad phi of x naught. I have only one possible choice for this, so I have only one possible choice for this, and because of injectivity, I have only one possible choice for this. So the theorem that I can state is this. If C1 satisfies the twist condition, and mu and nu are probabilities on Rn compactly supported, then mu is absolutely continuous with respect to the back measure, then the optimal gamma in Kantorovich is unique, concentrated on a graph of a map T, and T solves the Monge problem. So this is, we arrive exactly to what we wanted to prove. To use this, I need these optimality conditions. So I need to believe in min of the primal equals max of the dual. I will just finish to explain this and then I will be done. What do you do? Proof. So we know that grad x c x naught y naught equals grad phi y naught for every x naught such that there exists grad phi of x naught. Now remember that phi has the same modulus of continuity of C. So now maybe this was not so clear. So I just proved that there exists a maximizer. Now, if you take this maximizer, if you want, you can improve it, if it is not yet the case, by replacing phi with the transform of psi. So you can assume that the maximizer is made of C concave functions. So they have the same modulus of continuity of C. C is C1, but we take X and Y bounded, containing the support of mu and the support of nu. And if you want, I can assume that the support of mu, that I take X so large that the support of mu is contained in the interior. So C1 on bounded on compact sets implies Lipschitz. So C is Lipschitz, and so phi is Lipschitz. Then there is Rademacher theorem says that there exists grad phi almost everywhere. The Rademacher theorem is a theorem which says that Lipschitz functions are differentiable almost everywhere. Almost everywhere for the Lebesgue measure. But since I assumed, and this is an extra assumption which I never did before, that mu is absolutely continuous, then there exists grad phi of x naught for mu almost every x naught. So this property is satisfied by almost every point, because I'm not on the boundary, because I'm supposing that the support of mu is far from the boundary, and I am differentiable almost everywhere. So this implies that for almost every x naught, for mu almost every x naught, at most one point y naught can be such that x naught y naught is in the support of gamma, because I have the twist condition which guarantees that I can invert this, and this point y naught is, let's say, this minus one of grad phi zero, grad phi x zero, and this will be called t of x zero. So I have proven that my gamma is concentrated on a graph, because the points x naught where this is not true are negligible, so I can forget them. It's concentrated on a graph. Now, something which is important is that it is concentrated on this graph. I'm not only saying that it's concentrated on a graph, it is concentrated on a graph for which I gave an explicit formula, depending on phi and depending on c. So I also have the uniqueness. Now, this is something which is not done in this way in most of the books and courses on optimal transport. There is another trick which says that if you are able to prove that every optimal gamma comes from a transport map, that you cannot have, then you cannot have two optimal gamma, because by convex combination you would get one which does not come from a transport map. But in this case, you already have a precise transport map. I mean, this transport map does not depend on gamma. This is a magic coming from a convex duality, which is that I can take gamma phi psi any optimizer. So even if I have two different optimal gamma, I can use the same phi. If I use the same phi, it will be true that gamma will have the same, will come from the same transport map. So you see that this gives an answer to the Monge problem. Is it true that there exists an optimal map? Yes. Under which conditions? I need to have two compactly supported measures on RN. The first one should be absolutely continuous, so the starting one, then one which I want to transport to the other, and I need the cost to satisfy certain condition, which is essentially an invertibility of the derivative. I wrote C1 to write this. Maybe next time we will generalize a little bit. It's not really important the fact that C is C1. It's important that the derivative can be inverted. So in some sense, if you had a convex function, which is not C1, but it is strictly convex, it could be enough. But anyway, I will stop here for today because it's time. We will meet on Wednesday. And on Wednesday in particular, we start from proving the equality between the min and the max. And so really, please ask me questions whenever you want, whenever you need. And of course, slow me down every time that I go too fast.
Okay, so thank you, Filippo. I see that there is one hand from Stefanos. So please.
First question. Please. Is there a way of rewriting the dual problem instead of searching for phi and psi to search only for phi? Since we can see psi as the C transform of phi.
Definitely, definitely. It's a false problem on two variables because there is no reason to choose psi different from phi C. So you can write as a maximization on phi and you impose psi equals phi C, exactly. And you can also assume that phi is C concave, which is a very important point to get a compactness. I agree.
Thank you.
Okay, so if there are no more questions, we can thank Filippo for his first lesson today. It's very dense and instructive already. Okay, grazie. Grazie mille, Filippo. And okay, so we will resume this course on Wednesday at 4:30.
Four in the afternoon, yes. In the meanwhile, I will save what I wrote and add to the Teams channel and update the references on the web page. And so next time, as I said, we will start from the duality theorem.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Could you please also share the recording?
Sorry, yes.
About the recording.
Yes, the recording so far they should be in the channel, in the team channel. Okay. So the recording and the notes, the PDF notes, it will be Filippo will make them available, I think, also in the Teams channel. In any case, we will organize that a little bit now.
Okay, bye guys. Thanks a lot. See you. And if you have questions which come into your mind between now and Wednesday, feel free to ask on Wednesday.